the name of the Father, and of the Son,
and of the Holy Spirit, one God, Amen. Actually, as deacons, it is very important to understand the liturgy. And in understanding the liturgy, I want you to compare between three things: the sacrifices, the crucifixion of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the liturgy itself. When you compare between these three things, you will understand the depth of the divine liturgy. And sacrifices are mentioned in Leviticus, in the book of Leviticus, from chapter 1. And we call them five, but more accurately, they are four sacrifices and one offering. The four sacrifices, burnt offering or sacrifice. The word sacrifice in the Old Testament means shedding of blood. So the burnt offering, the peace offering, the trespass offering, the sin offering. And then the offering of flour. Flour, there is no shed of blood. So the total are five. And why they are five? Because one sacrifice is not enough to explain the depth of the sacrifice of Christ on the cross. So the five cover five different aspects from the sacrifice of our Lord Jesus Christ. And I want to differentiate between three words. Three words: sacrifice, oblation, and offering. Offering is a very broader name, very broad name. For example, offering can be used in the worship or can be used outside the worship. For example, I can offer candles to the church. It's used in the worship. I can use, I can offer wine. It can use to be used in the worship. But also I can offer a bus to the church. A bus will not used in worship. So bus, we call it offering. I don't call it sacrifice. I don't call it oblation. Oblation, in Arabic, which is taken from Syriac, Urban. Urban, I'm going to say this in Arabic, but Urban means ما أتقرب به إلى الله. So, Urban or oblation, something I used in worship. That's offering means something I used in worship. So candles are oblations. The book of readings are oblation. Oil, oblation. Oil that used for the candles. Wine is oblation. You know, all these are considered oblation. Sacrifice in the Old Testament means shedding of blood, like burnt offering or peace offering, blood is shed. In the New Testament, Christ shed his blood once for all. So sacrifice in the New Testament means to sacrifice yourself in worship to God. For example, when you forget completely about yourself to praise the Lord, it is a sacrifice of praise. As we say at the conclusion of the hymn through the intercession of Saint Mary, the Mother of God, sacrifice of praise. When you lift up your hands in prayer, here you are sacrificing your body, you know, lifting up your hands. So it's a sacrifice, as the Psalms said, consider lifting of my hands, evening sacrifice before you. So sacrifice in Greek, thysia. Thysia means to sacrifice yourself. That's why in the response to the litany of the oblation or offering, kephision should be translated our sacrifices, not our offering. And in Arabic, وَضَحَيَانَا وَزَبَائِحْنَا مِشْ وَضَقْدِمَاتِنَا. There is difference between offering, sacrifice, and qurban. So just, I want to explain this to you. And as an example, how you study the sacrifices in the book of Revelation, in the book of Leviticus, I will study today with you the first one, which is the burnt offering, and we will compare it with the crucifixion of our Lord Jesus Christ, and also we'll compare it with the Divine Liturgy. So you can connect these three things together. Now the Lord called to Moses and spoke to him from the tabernacle of meeting, saying, God used to speak to Moses from the tabernacle of meeting. You know from where? From the mercy seat between the two cherubims, the cover of the Ark of Covenant or Ark of Testimony. Speak to the children of Israel and say to them, when any one of you brings an offering to the Lord, you shall bring your offering of the livestock, of the herd, and of the flock. Just let me tell you, going back to the sacrifice, oblation, and offering, I can say every sacrifice is an offering, but not every offering is a sacrifice. Understand? Yeah. Offering is a wider circle. Inside it, a narrower circle called Qurban. Inside the Qurban, a narrower circle called sacrifice. So every sacrifice is Qurban, but not every Qurban is a sacrifice. And every Qurban is offering, but not every offering is Qurban and sacrifice. You understand? So here when the Lord spoke, offering, yeah, correct, it's a sacrifice. But every sacrifice is offering, but not the opposite. If he's offering a burnt sacrifice, so burnt sacrifice means the whole animal will be burned completely, except the skin. And we'll explain why. And I will explain which part of the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ it represents. And he gave him three options, either from herd, or from livestock, or from flock, and the third option from birds. So here, verse 3, if his offering is a burnt sacrifice of the herd, calves, let him offer a male without blemish. Why male? Okay. This sacrifice, the burnt offering, is completely to satisfy the justice of God. That's why it is burned completely. The peace offering is about making peace between God and us. And if God is the bridegroom and we are the bride, that's why the peace offering, it can be male or female. Because we are participating. But this concerning God only, that's why it's male only. Male only. Offer a male without blemish. Of course, without blemish, because it represents the offering of Christ. And he shall offer it of his own free will at the door of the tabernacle of meeting before the Lord. So he brings the offering at the door of the tabernacle of meeting. He shall put his hand on the head of the burnt offering, and it will be accepted on his behalf to make atonement for him. He shall kill the bull before the Lord. And the priests, Aaron's son, shall bring the blood and sprinkle the blood all around on the altar, that is, by the door of the tabernacle of meeting. And he shall skin the burnt offering and cut it into its pieces. The sons of Aaron, the priest, shall put fire on the altar and lay the wood in order on the fire. Then the priests, Aaron's son, shall lay the parts, the head, and the fat in order on the wood that is on the fire upon the altar. But he shall wash its entrails and its legs with water. And the priest shall burn all on the altar as a burnt sacrifice, an offering made by fire, a sweet aroma to the Lord. So let's take it step by step. We explained why it is meal, because it's sweet aroma to the Lord. It's how the Lord Jesus Christ offered himself as a burnt offering. In verse 3, he shall offer it at the door of the tabernacle of meeting before the Lord. This remind me with what? Remind me how we choose the lamb where? In the front of the door of the altar. So as the deacons or the priest bring to the celebrant priest the wine and the urban to choose the urban and the wine that's be used in the divine liturgy, where it is offered at the door. Why at the door? Because here he will examine the bull, and if it is without blemish, he will take it to the altar to sacrifice it. In the same way, Abuna will examine the bread and wine, and he will take the bread and wine that's without blemish to the altar. As the Lord Jesus Christ was examined before Pontius Pilate, the Lord was tried 6 trials, 3 religious and 3 civil trials. And after all this examination, he was found without blemish. How the examination is done? The examination, you can read it in the book of Acts, when they want to examine Paul, they scourged him. So scourging is a way to examine the person, the accused person, in order to confess whether he is guilty or not. And we differentiate in the suffering of our Lord Jesus Christ between the suffering of examination and the suffering of the cross. While he was on trial, the Lord was examined by 39 whips, and the servant slapped him on his face, and he put the crown of thorns on his head. So the 41 represent the 39 whips, the slap on the face when he told him, are you speaking to the high priest this way? And the crown of thorns. But the suffering or the pains of the crucifixion are five. Two nails in his hand, two nails in his feet, and the spear in his side. But the nails of the feet, they put the left foot and they fix it with one nail. Then they put the right above the left and they fix it with another nail. So from outside, you see it as if one nail, but one nail cannot fix the 2 feet together. And when they studied the shroud of our Lord Jesus Christ, they found 2 holes in the left feet, 1 hole in the right feet, which means they fixed the left foot with one nail, and then they put the right foot on top, and they fix it with another nail. So 4 nails and this spear. So we have 41 examination, pains or suffering, and 5 suffering of the cross. That's why in the Urbana we have 5 holes, refers to the 4 nails and the spear. The Lord was examined by whips. And while we examine the bread and wine, what are we chanting? Chanting, Lord have mercy, 41 times. Because we are examining now. So as he was examined by whips and by the slab and by the crown of thorns, so we are repeating the 41, Kyrie eleison, or Lord have mercy, because it's time of the examination. And after we finish the examination, we say the conclusion of the examination. Holy, 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 he is found without blemish. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Who is the sinner? It's us. That's why we say, absolve, remit, and forgive our transgression, which we committed knowingly and which we committed unknowingly. So you can see here how they bring the bull to the front of the door, how they brought Jesus Christ before 3 religious trials and 3 civil trials, and how we bring the bread and wine to the door to be examined. And Pilate, the final authority, he made, I examined this man and I found him with no guilt. When they examined the bull and found the bull without blemish, they took the bull to the altar to sacrifice it. That's why when the Lord, when Pilate said, I examined this man and I found no guilt in him, according to the law, they said, then crucify him, sacrifice him, without blemish. They did it without understanding, but they were fulfilling the law. He is a lamb without blemish. That's why they said, crucify him, crucify him. Then the person puts his hand, verse 4, on the head of the burnt offering to identify himself with the burnt offering. And it will be accepted on his behalf to make atonement for him. So, we identify ourselves with the Lord Jesus Christ. So when he offered himself as a burnt offering, we also are offered as burnt offering in him, because he took our humanity and he made it one with his divinity. So that is laying the hand on the head of the burnt offering. And that's why Abuna, if you notice, especially the altar deacon, after he takes the bread and enters into the altar, he lays his hand, he carries the urbana between his hand like this, and then he lays his hand on it, and he starts to say all the commemorations, all the prayers, while he's laying his hand. Exactly like here, he put his hand on the burnt offering. So we will be one, identified with the Lord Jesus Christ. So in him, the Father will smell this sacrifice as a sweet aroma. He shall kill the bull before the Lord. And the priests, Aaron's son, shall bring the blood and sprinkle it, the blood all around on the altar. That's by the door of the tabernacle of meeting. So they sacrifice, they kill the bull and took the blood and sprinkle it all over the world, all over the altar, which means all over the world. The blood of our Lord Jesus Christ is enough to forgive all sins for all people in all ages. That is the meaning of sprinkling the blood around the altar. We don't actually now slain the offering, because Jesus was slain once for all. But we have the blood separate from the body. We have the blood in a chalice and the body in the pitim. Why you have them separate? Because he is a sacrifice. His blood was shed. And that's why the Lord, when he gave communion, he emphasized it on two different actions. Take, eat, this is my body. Take, drink, this is my blood. Because he is a sacrifice. That's why it's not right to mix them together. We do it only in very exceptional situation, when Abuna goes and give communion to somebody who is sick in his house or in a hospital. But other than this, we don't mix them together, because it's a sacrifice. And even St. Paul in 1 Corinthians 11, he said, I handed to you what I received from the Lord himself. He took bread and told them, take, eat, this is my body. He took blood, the wine, and told them, take, drink, this is my blood. So these two different actions, separate from each other, we cannot actually mix them together. Then he shall skin the burnt offering and cut it into pieces. You know, on the Lord Jesus Christ, they took his garment off. And here they skin it. Why? Do you remember Adam, when he sinned, God made tunic of skin to cover him? And from where he got the skin? Because he offered a burnt offering sacrifice. So the skin that was taken from sacrifice was made skin, a tunic of skin to cover Adam. In the same way, God covers our nakedness by his righteousness. So now we are covered in Christ, covered by his grace. That's why they don't burn the skin, because the skin covered Adam. So here, when we partake of his body and his blood, we are covered by his grace. Then cut it into pieces. And the sons of Aaron shall put fire on altar and lay the wood in order on the fire. What are the pieces? He spoke about four pieces here. Then the priest, Aaron's son, shall lay the parts, the head, the first piece, the fat, in order on the wood, second piece, then wash the entrails and its legs with water, and the priest shall burn all on the altar as a burnt sacrifice, an offering made by fire, a sweet aroma to the Lord. So we have the head, we have the fat, and we have the entrails and the legs and the rest of the sacrifice, and we have the blood that was sprinkled all around. These four parts are very important. Why? The head represents the mind or the thoughts. The blood represents the soul, because the soul of the animal in his blood. The fat represents the energy, the mind, because when the fat is burned, it turns into energy. And the rest of the parts have the heart, and the heart is the most important part of the rest of the body. So here we have the heart, the brain, the blood, the soul, and the fat burned completely to please God. Do you remember when the Lord said, love the Lord your God from all your thoughts, that's the head, from all your heart, from all your soul, that's the blood, and from all your power or might, that's the fat. So here, when these parts are burned completely, as if a person is burned with fire completely. So my heart completely love God. I love Him with all my thoughts. I love Him with all my mind. I love Him with all my soul. Then he repeated the same thing about if it is taken from the sheep or goats, the same steps, and from the bird, the same steps. So I want just to explain to you how, what happened on the sacrifices, exactly what happened on the cross, exactly what happened in the divine liturgy. Last point I want just mention here, you know, during the circuit of incense, when Abuna encircled the church with incense, at this time we should actually ask God to forgive us our sins. So as if Abuna is collecting our sins in the censer. That's why when he goes back to the altar, he prays, O God who accepted the confession of the thief on the cross, accept the confession and repentance of your people. We say that the censer represents Saint Mary and the aroma represents Jesus. And Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes the sins of the whole world. So if the aroma represents Jesus, then Abuna is taking the sins of the people and put it above the incense, above Jesus Christ, because He is the Lamb of God who carries the sins of the world. And then before the institution narrative, Abuna takes the incense and put it on the bread and wine. This incense carries what? The sins of the people. So Abuna takes the sins of the people and put it on the bread and wine. So as Jesus carried our sins, here he actually, upon him was laid all the sins and the transgression of the people. It is how they put the hand on the head of the offering, and then the sins actually is transferred or become identified with the sacrifice from the person who is confessing his sins to the sacrifice. I hope in this simple yani introduction to the sacrifices, when you read the book of Leviticus, don't just feel it is boring and you don't understand it. Actually, it's beautiful, especially if you try to connect it and compare it with the crucifixion of our Lord Jesus Christ and also with the divine liturgy. Glory be to God forever and ever. Amen. I will answer now some of your questions. If everything has a cause, this statement is not accurate, because not everything has a cause. I can say everything has a cause except God, because he is the cause of everything. And the rest of the question, why does God have cause? Because he is the cause of everything. God is the source and the cause of everything. Everything but God has a cause. But God is the only being who has no cause. What's your opinion on the new hymns coming out and being said to be revived? If they are authentic, definitely I will support these hymns. But sometimes they take hymns from the Eastern family, like Greek Orthodox Church, whatever, and they add it to our hymnology. I don't like this. But if there is a hymn we found, like old recording by Cantor Michael or Cantor Tawfiq or Cantor Fahim, it's our responsibility to revive it. Absolutely, I will support it. How can we modify Kyahk midnight praises for an American English church? Many of the Arabic melodies do not translate well and are theologically inept. You know, actually, we started a project about 2 years ago, retranslating the Arabic melodies into English. And actually, we translated many, I can say more than 50 or 60% of the melodies, and we published them on Coptic Reader. And I'm sure, yeah, if you use the most updated version of Coptic Reader, you will find these are updated. They rhyme well and good theology. I'm sure some of you noticed the difference between the old ones and what is used now. And God willing, we are working on finishing the rest of the translation. And we formed a committee from fathers who grew up here and English is their first language to give feedback. You are from this, and Abuna Theodore is one actually of this committee. We have so many lost sheep. Do we have a priest and deacons who are determined in this service? Actually, it is the responsibility of every church. يعني here مثلا سان فيرينا it's the responsibility of Abuna and he can do a committee or a servant for the lost sheep ministry different than the servant of Sunday school. And actually and I discussed with the fathers that we need to have in every church a list for the lost sheep. And then we classify them based on why they are considered lost. For example, these are drugs, these are sexual immorality, these are atheists, these are just busy with their life, not interested in spirituality, etc., etc. And then we train people, for example, we train servant how to deal with the atheist, we train servant how to deal with the drug addict, we train servants how to deal with sexually immoral people, etc. And then we assign these servants, the people from the lost sheep, to lost sheep means one-to-one ministry, visitation, meeting one-to-one. And with Yami, the year before last year, we started our first conference for the lost sheep ministry and lost sheep servants. The last year was canceled because of COVID. This year was scheduled in October, this month, but because the conflict with the visit of the conference of Abuna Dawood Lamai, so we rescheduled, I think, in February. Yeah, February or January, something like this. I think February. So the lost sheep servants conference, God willing, yeah, it's rescheduled, I think, in February 2022. Why is King Constantine considered a saint by the church when he was an Arian? Actually, there is some wrong information about he was baptized but Arian, but many sources confirm this was confusion, but he was, yani, at the end of his days, he was baptized with an Orthodox Arian priest, and I have the reference if you are interested, just yani, if you can text me or call me, I will send you the reference about how he was baptized by a non-Arian. That's why you consider him as a saint. What is something constructive the SUS Cops Deacons need to improve in? And thank God, and our deacons in general are excellent, but in general, we need how to use our responsibility as deacons to glorify God and actually to make the people interested in worship. Sometimes the performance of the deacon can actually be a stumbling block to the people, or their performance can take the people into a higher level of spirituality. So all of us, we need to work on this point, how in our prayers and our performance we pray with the spirit and with understanding. This actually will help the people to be taken into a higher level of spirituality. What are your thoughts on Abuna Athanasius Ilma'ari research regarding the litany's kneeling prayer? You know, Abuna is a scholar, and What I like about his writing, he just document everything from manuscripts. And he mentioned several times, I'm just saying that's how the ritual developed, and he support everything he's saying by manuscripts. But he said, please don't change anything when you read my books. To change anything in the ritual, it is only the authority of the Holy Synod. So if you read something in his books that's different than what we practice right now, we cannot just change it. But we need actually to wait until the Holy Synod make a resolution about it. With all the changes in time and language, do you see the Eastern Orthodox Church rejoining us in communion? Actually, unfortunately, and this is my personal opinion, not the opinion of the Church, but I see with the new theology that Eastern Orthodox Church is adopting, I see the gap is getting bigger and wider between both families. Now, يعني, the denying the original sin, the denying the penal substitution, many things actually. And during, just before the meeting, I was speaking with Abuna about this new theology, about the energy and the essence, and how they say that the energy of God is His essence. And I have quotes from early church fathers said, no, there is distinction between energy and essence. So unfortunately, the gap is getting wider, not closer. But we pray for the unity. We pray that all of us, we seek the truth and go back to the knowledge of truth. This is what will unite us. What's your favorite hymn? Many hymns actually, but I like to know in Sok, we follow you with all our hearts. I feel it is like renewing your vow every morning to the Lord. How do we deal with people who want family chanters in the church, especially when our sister church have a role for women? You know, chanting is the responsibility of the whole congregation. Yani, when you look at the liturgy book, it says people, not deacons. And the chanters who are ordained chanters just to lead the congregation. But actually, when we say in him, everyone in the church should be chanting together, whether male or female. Lakin, there is no deaconesses in the church, meaning a deacon, a deaconess to chant or to read, or to lead chanting or to read or to enter the altar. Saint Mary was not Absartus, although she is the mother of God and higher than all the patriarchs. So I think we need to respect the gender difference that God instituted for us, and be humble like Saint Mary. What is the significance of the procession of the cross with the gospel reading during the matins of the Feast of the Cross and Hosanna Sunday? On the Feast of the Cross, they used actually to stand in front of every icon and read the appropriate gospel. So we are carrying the cross, which is considered like our flag or our mark that gives us victory over Satan and defeat Satan by the power of the cross. And in the past, actually, every church has different reading based on the icons they have. But when they published the book of the procession of the cross back in 1902, they actually chose the reading that was read in the old cathedral in Al-Azbakiya and used the order of the icons in this church. And that's how it became actually the reading in all the churches in the Coptic church. But originally, every church chose certain reading based on the icons they have in their church. That's for the Feast of the Cross. For the Hosanna Sunday, it represents the journey of our Lord Jesus Christ entering into Jerusalem. With all the changes happening with other projects to change the English Tasbiha, does Coptic reader plan to change? You know, there are some changes in Coptic reader, and we published a letter about 3 weeks ago or 1 month ago about the changes. We change only if there is a theological mistake or the current translation is not accurate with the Coptic. But based on preference, we don't change because people already memorized what we have right now. But if, for example, if there is a word was translated wrong theologically, we cannot keep it. And the same way, if there is missing a translation, we will change it. What is the daily spiritual canon of a deacon? And at least, of course, he has to discuss with his father of confession, but at least in the first hour and the 12th hour from the Igbeya and some prostration beside some spiritual reading and maybe one or two chapters from scripture, and fasting Wednesday and Friday and all the fasts of the church. We have a new marble altar, Mabruk. Why do we have to cover it? Because that is the right way. And why doesn't other church cover it? I don't know, you can ask them. The altar has three covering. And if you have the book, The Church House of God by Abuna Tadros Malati, he explained the three covering. The first covering goes all the way down. The second covering is like mafresh like this, you know. And the third covering is considered the prosferin. And usually in the church, we don't boast with marble and gold and silver. You know, all the glory of the daughter of the king is within. And if you see the tabernacle of meeting from inside, a lot of gold, a lot of silver, but from outside, it was covered by the skin of animals. From outside, has no beauty. It's like Jesus on the cross. From outside, he looks weak, but from inside, he is the Lord of Lords and God of Gods. So the altar that represents Jesus Christ himself, as Isaiah said, he has no beauty or shape to look at him from outside on the cross. So when now we are yani competing to make out of beautiful marble, you know, and then we don't want to cover it, this actually distracts as if the beauty of the altar in the marble. No, the beauty of the altar in the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, not in the marble, not in the wood, not in the gold, not in the whatever you are using it. Why cannot Abuna shorten his hair or cut his beard? Don't tell him that again. Why cannot Abuna wear shorts and play sports? There is something called the reverence of the priesthood. He's our father, and he is the representative of God. So the reverence of the priesthood actually, and not caring about, again, the same principle about how we look from outside. More importantly, from inside, a big heart that contains everybody. But just focusing on external looks, of course, this is not right. And also, wearing short is not right. There is, where is the reference of priesthood? There is no reference here. It's a representative of God. Where does antiphonary come from? It's like the rest of the liturgical text. Why does, if not always, match the synaxarium? Because they follow two different calendars that coincide with each other in many things, but they are different from each other. And why does not every synaxarium saint have an entry? As I told you, they used two different calendars. Two different calendars for the saints. That's why the difference between, there's difference sometimes between antiphonary and the synaxarium. Why do we not have full deacon in our Nashville churches to help our priest? You know, full deacon should be like the priest. He should be consecrated full time. He should be wearing black. He should not be working. That's the canons of the apostles. And yani, God forbid, if his wife departed, he cannot marry again. He should be a husband of one wife only. And also, his responsibility is bigger than just helping in communion. Unfortunately, many churches, they ordain a deacon just to help Abuna in communion. And I said to the fathers here, also, and helping in communion, giving out blood is a great honor to the deacon, but he has more responsibility than this. So I'm not going to ordain a full deacon just to help him in communion. Either to give him the whole responsibilities according to the teaching and the canons of the apostles, or to wait until we are ready. Simply, the triangle of the priesthood, we have the deacon, the priest, and the bishop. Deacon responsible for administrative and financial affairs of the church. As you read in Book of Acts, chapter 6, priest responsible for the spiritual affairs of the church. That's why the apostle said, it's not right to leave the word of God and serve the tables. Then both of them report to the bishop. That is the triangle. But now, actually, most of the churches, we follow the rule, buy one, get one free. So our priest in charge of the spiritual, administrative, and financial affairs of everything. When we are ready to have the priest only devoted for spiritual and deacons, for deacons in charge of course, helped by the board of deacons, in charge of the financial and administrative, and doing this under the supervision of the priest, of course, and both of them report to the bishop, I here only I will ordain for deacon. but just I'm not going to ordain for deacon and allow him to work and not to wear black and to just to give communion on Sunday. That's not right. That's not the rules or the canons of the church. How can we as deacons ensure that we are not stumbling blocks? Don't fight with each other on the altar, on the chorus. Pray. Don't chant with boasting with your voice, but chant with the spirit of prayer, the spirit of humbleness, love one another. This actually will help you not to be stumbling block. Why are there both Mu'akkab and I didn't even tell it about Rumi, but so good. Muhakkab, Shaykh. Explanations for the Theotokia during Vespers praise in Kahf. Actually, there are more than this. There are, I think, 4 or 5 Coptic and Greek and 5 Arabic explanations. So there are many explanations. We don't have to say all of them. Traditionally, we say only 5, and now they became 3, and now some churches became 1. But traditionally, we say from the Greek and Coptic, Rumi wal Ma'ab, and from Al Arabi, from the Arabic or English, we say Abu Al Sa'd, Al Ma'alim Gabriel, Al Ma'aqab Al Arabi, and Al Patriarch Morgus. And I think many tafsir, many explanations, because you want to spend longer time in the church, so every cantor composed, or patriarch, or priest composed explanation. So now it's very rich inheritance that can make you choose from this rich inheritance one or more from these explanations. Why do we use the shepherd staff for the bishop? Because the bishop is the shepherd. Using the staff is to remind the bishop with his responsibility to shepherd the flock of God. What are good practices for all readers? To read well, and to read well, and to make the sense when they read. To read slowly, with a clear voice, and to make the sense. Reading a question is different than reading an answer. But some people read just in the beginning with the word was God, and God was... No, and nobody understands. You need to read, in the beginning was the word, and the word was God. So people can understand. Do readers need to mention the popes during the liturgy? Yes. There is a response that says, let the reader recite the names of our patriarchs. And we used to put a list of all the departed patriarchs on the altar. So when the deacon says, let the reader read, so the reader can read all these names inaudibly, silently. What advice would you give us as we start evangelism programs in our church? Evangelism mainly to preach the gospel of salvation. Some churches, when we speak about evangelism, it end up just giving food to the homeless, and that's it. This is a charitable, but I cannot call it evangelism. Evangelism, besides giving them food or visiting sick or whatever, you need to speak and to preach the gospel of salvation to others. How do we battle lukewarmness, for example, singing hymns without meaning behind it in the chanter's heart? That's why I said you need to chant with spirit and with understanding. For example, any hymn, today we said Rejoice, O Mary, because the 21st, and we said Benishti. You need actually to think about the meaning and to interact with it and to see it in a spirit of prayer. Yes, sometimes we get distracted, but again, I will recollect my thoughts and focus to spirit, to pray in spirit and in truth. Today is Halloween. No, today is Sunday. Is it okay to dress up as an innocent person, like a police or firefighter, and go with my friend? Why is Halloween bad? There are many articles, and I wrote an article, and His Grace Bishop Surian wrote an article about the origin of Halloween. And Halloween is celebrating death and celebrating Satan, and we don't celebrate Satan. And we don't celebrate death, we celebrate resurrection. So we don't participate in the works of darkness, rather rebuke them. Some churches actually on the new Coptic year, which is September 11, they allow their children to be dressed like martyr or saints and come to the church, you know. And I think that is, and for the children who want to dress in certain costumes, they can do this on the feast of the new Coptic year. But Halloween, Christians should not actually celebrate or participate, because as I told you, it is celebration of death. We celebrate resurrection. How does one begin to live for the Lord? You need actually to make your goal very clear: salvation, heaven, eternal life. And you start with your spiritual canon as guided by your father of confession, and stay away from sin, fight sin that could fight, and grow in your spiritual life. One of the best books can help you is Life of Repentance and Purity by His Holiness Pope Shenouda. This book will help you very much. Of course, I'm answering quick answers, and every question like this can be a lecture, but just I'm giving quick answers in order to cover all the questions. Beside, yani, I think I went over time right now. If I go to an engagement or wedding and I dance innocently, there is no innocent dance, with my friend, is it really sin? Do I need to confess or not sir? I don't know what you mean by innocent dance. There is no innocent dance, and don't tell me that what happens in wedding and reception is innocent. No, it is not. And as I said, we as children of God, we need actually to be different from the rest of the world, because we are children of God. Dancing usually is accompanied by drinking, and people get drunk, and the whole atmosphere is ungodly. Psalm 1 says, blessed is the man who walks not in the way of the ungodly, doesn't sit with the scornful. So we should separate ourselves. We are children of God, we are deacons, we are servants of the Lord. I should not actually be conformed to the children of this world. And as a deacon, you should not actually participate in dancing. As I told you, there is nothing called innocent dancing. God be with you through the intercession of Saint Mary, Saint Louis, and Saint Verena. Glory be to God forever and ever. Amen.